along, Spitfire. Welcome to We Have Ways of Making You Talk, very special edition on video for those Patreons that we have, and then listening for the listeners on the normal podcast. Where are we, James?
Well, we're at Biggin Hill. We've got skylarks above us, haven't we? You know,
perfect blue sky. Some cirrus, I think. I'm not a clouds expert.
But a man who could describe
the sky for us and much else besides is Peter Monk, because we're at the Heritage Hangar here at Biggin Hill. Those of you who've been watching Inside the Spitfire Factory, the voiceover guy is my highlight. We'll know Peter from his extraordinary business here, restoring Spitfires mainly, although there is a hurricane in bits in there.
There is
several hurricanes.
Yeah, there's three actually at the moment. Yeah,
wow, fantastic. Three hurricanes, but you know, Spitfires there where the action is. We're on the tarmac. Well, it's not
no
tarmac,
more one,
is it?
Though.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
On the concrete here with a Mark 9 twin seater being set up for someone going for a flight.
They're getting strapped in. Look, they're given the safety brief, which is very important. So they need to understand what's going on and need to understand how to get out in the event of an emergency, which is very rare. It's not going to happen, basically, but we need to be aware of all. And you can see that the canopy is just about to be closed and the engine just about to be started.
It's the stuff of dreams, isn't
Blimey.
It? Stuff
now,
of dreams.
Now,
so I've just walked past the two-seater Hurricane. Oh, my God. Very, very tempted.
Yeah, well, we're here. You know.
I know. But you know,
the Patreons will pay for it, won't
you?
And, you know. Now, Peter, tell us about this aircraft in particular. Although we are about to get blasted out. Tell us about this plane.
Very special, this one. As a single seater, before it was converted into a two seater, which we've obviously now get the benefit of taking passengers up in. It served with the Canadian Air Force, a Royal Canadian Air Force, and on the 27th of September 1944. It was credited with a victory over a 109 over Arnhem. So it was patrolling Arnhem while all the parachutists were being dropped. And the pilot officer, Sid Bregman, 19-year-old, shot down a Messerschmitt 109.
Same age as my son. Jesus.
Unbelievable.
Blimey.
Yeah.
So it's very special. So here it is, preserved. It's fairly original.
You've got his logbook, haven't you?
We have. We've got his logbook.
Because you try with the aircraft to gather as much history as you possibly can, don't you?
So we do.
It's not just an airframe that...
And there it is.
Wow.
Sort of, you know, RF blue. Royal Canadian Air Force pilot's flying logbook. Name, Sidney Bregman.
Yeah, Bregman.
And his number.
Yeah.
Again, he only died a couple of years ago. And
where's the fatal day? Fateful day?
Let me just find it for you.
July. God, they fly a lot, don't
they?
Armed reconnaissance.
There it is, and even we have some photographs here, which are stills from the
camera gun. That's a 109G, isn't it?
It is 109G, and you can see parts there which are obviously being
struck
and leaving the aircraft. And there we have.
So what date is that?
The 27th of September, 1944.
Wow.
And he says, 1109G destroyed.
And we were just talking to one of your chaps next door, and he was saying that the reason he was able to hit it was because he had a drop tank on at the time. The drop tank had just run out of fuel and started to splutter. And so he was fiddling around trying to switch tanks, looked up, the rest of the squadron had gone, and at that moment the 109 came in front of him.
That's exactly right. So you can just imagine.
Had he not been faffing with his fuel tanks, he wouldn't have shot
it down. Head down, faffing around, as you say, and loss of formation. But that left him alone with this 109, which he fortunately was able to sort out. So
absolutely incredible.
And this is a Mark 9, isn't it? Well, it's a TR-9 now.
But, it is.
But a Mark 9 when it was first born. And, you know, everyone always says that this is the kind of the pilot's favourite, isn't it?
It is.
You know, I know there's 14s with the Griffin and all the rest of it. And a lot of people love the Mark 8s, those who flew them out in the Far East and stuff. But the Mark 9 is a thing of perfection, isn't it, really?
I think it's it had the greatest use. It's just about to start.
Look, here we go.
Isn't it great? This is the moment where you hope the propeller doesn't fly off.
Yeah, absolutely. It'd go that way, wouldn't it, though?
I suppose.
It's going clockwise, isn't it?
Clockwise?
There he goes. It'll be a few minutes before he takes off.
Yeah.
We're now into autumn and cooler temperatures. It'll probably be 10 minutes or so before he takes off. So he can taxi over and we've taken off in a northerly direction today. Northerly wind, hence it being a bit chillier.
Yeah.
And we'll hear him running the engine very shortly, just doing the usual pre-flight checks.
Where do you come by a Mark 9 like that then?
Well, in all fairness, that aircraft has been in circulation for some years. It was restored and first flew in the mid-90s.
Right.
So it was known and it was advertised for sale around about 6 years ago. In fact, I was pipped to the post at the time and a friend of mine bought it before I did.
Right.
And then he sold it to me, no doubt for a profit. But now we've got
it. What a base for, eh?
Yeah, I know, absolutely. So now we've got it here at the hangar and it's working hard and working well. And all the time we can keep the passenger side of it running.
Yeah.
It help to preserve the future of it.
Yeah.
Very expensive.
In a war, I think they'd get about 200 hours, is that right, out of a Merlin? Something like that?
The life expectancy of a Spitfire was very short, so it was probably unknown exactly how many hours you could get. But now we budget for 500 hours.
Do you?
We generally take the engines out, anything over 400, providing it's still running nicely, we take the engine out, send it away for overhaul. So that's what we work on.
And if you needed a new Merlin, what do you do if you need a new engine?
You can still get new boxed parts, which we use in the engines.
Right.
So
brand new
in the box
from Rolls-Royce.
Well, they're not. We use a lot of Packard parts these days, which are the American engines.
These are parts that were built back in the war, but just never opened.
That's right, absolutely. So they're sealed up in boxes. We can't just use them.
No,
I have to emphasise that we have to check all the parts just because they're new in the box.
Yeah.
Or unused in the box doesn't mean to say that they're
metal has been finished or whatever. Yeah, yeah.
So we have to check every part, but it's a good place to be because what they won't have suffered from is wear.
Yeah,
yeah. Which is obviously what's happening now. We're wearing these things out.
And your Mark 9 that's about to take off now. I mean, how hard would you be? You're saying it's working hard, but I mean, how many hours is that doing over in a year?
That aeroplane this year will have flown about 200 hours now because of obviously the coronavirus thing that we've got going on at the moment.
Yes.
That, what were you talking about?
The pestilence.
It's flown a lot less than it would have done normally, but it would do around 350 to 400 hours in a year. So it's one engine a year.
Right.
That's what we're looking at.
Right. Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I mean, the process of overhauling an engine, I mean, the Merlins are complicated bits of kit, aren't they? I mean, any inline engine is a complicated bit of kit. And Merlin especially so, Griffin obviously even more so. I mean, is it a big palaver to do that? Is that a...
It's an expensive palaver.
Is it?
I'll say that much, but it's something that we have to do. We've got to obviously make sure that we maintain the safety of the aircraft and the operation, and the engine's key to that. So, but fortunately, the parts, as I said, are available at the moment. And we wouldn't be beyond making new if
And
we
if
had.
Not, you have to fabricate
new parts.
Yeah,
exactly.
Because... When you're restoring an aircraft, if there's a part that, because after all, the interesting thing about the Spitfire, when you look at the way it was produced, is it's on the cusp of proper mass production.
It is,
but it isn't actually properly mass produced.
No,
they are essentially artisan made in a mass production style. So every rivet is individually riveted. It's not punched on a jig, so that they're identical and interchangeable. So you end up with this weird. It's a strange moment in British mass production that actually then carries on into the 50s and 60s and into car production and all the all the problems we had with those industries. That you've got a thing that on the face of it is mass produced but isn't at all. So when you're restoring a Spitfire, that must be quite a problem, yeah?
Well, actually, it's not, because most of the parts, well, pretty much all of it, in fact, the airframe, if we have to manufacture any of it, is handmade.
Right.
Therefore, it's never going to... If we make it to fit one aircraft, we couldn't remove it
and stick it on another.
Next.
Yeah, yeah.
And we are one by one restoring these aeroplanes. They're not mass produced. We're not taking parts off the shelf. We'll have a project. We'll start with whatever we start with. If we have to replace or manufacture, then it makes it, in fact,
but the dials and controls and everything, those are essentially mass produced.
Yeah, they are. That's right. And you'll find dials, instruments from Spitfires, also fit Hurricanes, another period aircraft. So, yes, they are.
But you've built up all your machine tools here and you can basically make anything you need to make, pretty much, can
you? Yes, that's right. After we do, but that's not strictly true. The engines, we subcontract those. There are airframe parts that we are already using established contractors to make some of those parts, wing spars and so on. Yeah. So we don't do it all here. We could if we have to, but because it's just one by one,
with our projects, there is no need.
Yeah, you're not churning out like 300 a week.
No. We couldn't quite manage that.
Yeah. Would that make them more or less expensive?
Well, that's a point, actually. But as it is, let's say we manage as we are, and it works.
Yeah. How long have you been doing this, then?
We started here at Biggin Hill back in 2011, so just 9 years. Right. So we've come quite a way in that time. The two-seater operation has helped.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Because funding these aircraft, the problem is they're expensive to restore, but the meter keeps running. Yeah. As soon as you've restored it, then you've got to maintain the status quo. The airplane's got to be kept airworthy.
Yeah.
And that almost needs an open checkbook.
And everyone's multitasking, aren't they? So it's not like you've got a team of irks to make sure the flying aircraft fly. No. Everyone's doing a bit of everything.
They are, exactly. Including with me occasionally cleaning the floor, the toilets and the rest of it, because we have to.
It is amazing, though. I mean, coming to a place like this and you wander around and there's a kind of sort of a Spitfire wing in the process of being made, and there's the sort of engine cowlings off, and you're looking at the Merlin, and you really can get and have a look at the sort of the granular detail of a Spitfire, can't you? Here, and it's amazing to see. You really does make you really appreciate just how complex these machines were, and really how advanced technologically the world had come by kind of the late 1930s.
Yeah, it varies when you walk through our hangar. They say, depending on the stages of restoration, at the moment, we say we've got the Greek aeroplane, which is now finished, so that's completely covered. You can't see much going on there in the way of workings. And we've got another aircraft which is just about to fly. It's within days of flying, but 2 weeks ago, there wasn't a cover. You could see every sort of working, you see the engine, you see all the pipes, and then you come in today and it's complete. So it depends when you walk through the hangar. It's a very different picture. It's constantly changing.
Okay, we can hear
but we can't see.
We can't see it because of the slight incline.
Any minute now. There it is. Oh, it's always a joy. It's an old cliche, but you never get tired of that sound, do you? You just don't.
No, you don't. No, makes you proud to be British, that sound. There's not much of that around at the moment, is there?
No.
Oh, listen to that. You can see the invasion stripes on the wings. You see
that?
There's two reasons for us putting those on there. The first reason is it wore them during the war, so why not? But the second reason, it makes it easier to be seen by the other air traffic. They can't see it because the camouflage works.
That's a good point.
Yeah, it does work. So you get the odd alarmed Cessna pilot that's flying along on a Sunday afternoon and a Spitfire whizzes by. I didn't see it till the last minute.
No.
So we've got to put something on there that the other pilots can see.
Camouflage works.
Oh, it bloody does.
It's the thing that's always made me wonder. Like, did he ever really work? Did anyone fall?
Oh, yeah.
The 41 pattern was better than the 40.
Yeah. Yeah, of course. Yeah, I can't disagree with that.
But then, brown.
The American Mustangs are all left. They're all they're shone up in their aluminium, aren't they?
That's right. Yeah, absolutely.
To go quicker.
Yeah.
Wow. So, how did you get into Spitfires in the first place? Were you raised on the like Spitfire teat, like I was, like my dad?
No, not really.
Not really.
I went to an air show just purely by chance in 1980 at Westmorling Airfield, which isn't far from here now. It's no longer, it's a housing estate. Mm. And
lots of Douglas Bader ways and things around there, aren't there?
As usual, yeah. And so I went along to the air show and just watched these aeroplanes flying around, Spitfires.
Yeah.
Well, in fact, there was only a couple then.
Yeah.
They were rare to see.
Yeah.
But I just watched in awe of them. And I just thought, one day, I'd like to fly one of those. So I was a long way away from it then, driving around in a Ford Cortina with the wheel arches rusting off, but as we all did. But but it was, there's always a way, isn't there? You make things possible, and really that's what happened. So,
you learned to fly?
Yes, I did. I learned to fly. I started to learn when I was 19. And a few years after that, I gained my commercial license and went into commercial flying and then airline flying.
Yeah.
But that was just a way of earning a living.
Right.
It seemed enjoyable at the time, but the main driver behind all of this was to fly a Spitfire. And obviously to do that, you need a pilot's license. So I did buy a trainer, a World War II trainer, to get the right background to fly a Spitfire.
Yeah.
And restored that myself.
Right.
And in one of the sheds at Westmorling, the airfield we've just been talking about, shortly before it closed. So, in fact, it was the last aircraft to fly out of there. So I restored that and managed to get onto the air show scene flying this Harvard.
Yeah.
And just purely by chance, I was invited to fly a Spitfire. It belonged to the Netherlands Air Force. Hmm. I was still quite young then.
Yeah.
Normally people wait till they're in their 50s usually to get to fly these aircraft, but I was extremely lucky. And this was back in 94. This was great. I mean, it was a marvellous experience. You always remember your first solo flight in a Spitfire when you're learning, but the first flight in the Spitfire is what does it for me. I was extremely fortunate.
Are you nervous? A few nerves?
Yes, I was. I can recall being sat in this thing. I'd never even started one. I'd not been even that close. So I was invited to go and fly this aircraft, the Spitfire, in Holland.
What, you get given a manual, do you?
Basically, it's a blue, a small blue Air Ministry book.
Mm-hmm. Pilot's Notes.
A few pages, very basic. It just basically tells you how to start the engine and switch it on and off you go. And the commander-in-chief of the Netherlands Air Force was present.
Oh, God.
So that was... a bit tense, but
someone must have said, just stop pulling back on the stick at X speed. Yeah,
in fact, I'd sat in this aircraft.
Is it takeoff speed about 90, is it?
About 80 miles an hour. It starts to become light, and as it quickly accelerates, it takes itself off, really. It's really a nothing deal.
Okay.
But I recall starting the engine, taxiing out, opening the throttle, getting airborne, and just being a couple of minutes away for the airfield. I didn't wander far because I was over unfamiliar territory in Holland. I just wanted to keep the airfield in sight.
Yeah.
And then I looked out over these elliptical wings. There they were, the roundels. And it all of a sudden dawned on me, what the hell are you doing this aeroplane? You've got to land it. You've got to land it in front of the commander-in-chief of the Netherlands Air Force. It's taxpayers' money that have got this thing here. Yeah, I shouldn't even be here, you know. British National in Holland, but anyway, I landed it and taxied in, shut down, and the
did he bounce?
No, in fact, it was
perfect 3-point. Yeah,
well, I must have misjudged it because it went perfectly. So, rarity, you can never mean to land an aircraft perfectly every time. It's usually because you weren't quite expecting it, and it ends up right. But
and everyone talks about Spitfires being these kind of thoroughbreds, and that when you're first flying it, it's more like,
one second, there's a Cessna going by. Is it Cessna?
Don't care about that at all. but they talk about it being a thoroughbred, and that how you're sort of strapped and become part of it, and you look back and the airfield's a dot and all that. I mean, did you have those experiences?
Oh, very much so. So after that first flight, I was asked if I'd flown over there in my own aircraft, which seemed all of a sudden insignificant.
It must have been a bit of a come down.
Well, it was. Transit
and Barry Macko, the commander of the Netherlands Air Force, said, look, he said, we've got to get this aircraft back to the UK. It's taking part in the show next week. It would make sense if you could fly it back for us. He said, it's your choice. He said, we can look after your aircraft. You have to trust us with it.
Yeah.
And we'll look after it, and you can take the Spitfire back. I thought, you can have my aeroplane. I'll take the Spitfire back. But when I set off, I said that second flight, which was only about an hour or so later after completing the first solo. So I set off, and then I started to appreciate the characteristics of this aircraft, and honestly, it was unbelievably easy to fly. So as you say, the strapping on, you're thinking about turning left and right, and it already does it. Yes, it does, because it flies perfectly, and it's not a difficult aeroplane to fly. But that trip home was quite something.
Oh, I bet it was.
It was.
I bet it was.
Yeah, yeah. It was, absolutely.
So I had. What an amazing thing to do.
I know. It was just
amazing. So you're flying over the channel?
Yeah, I was. Yeah. I remember flying down the Belgian coast, heading towards the shortest distance across the channel, which was Calais and across. And as I turned and headed off across the channel there and looking at the white cliffs, it's all of a sudden dawned on me that, you know, those youngsters flying these aeroplanes, looking at the white cliffs and those experiences, and there I was without any of that sort of stress.
Yeah, no one trying to kill
you. And I could enjoy the aircraft, but honestly, that sort of almost brought a tear to my eye. Almost.
I bet it did.
It was a fantastic experience.
Oh, wow, and so I'm from then on, you're like, well, I'm going to have to get one of these. And
well, the problem is, it's okay, you're flying an aeroplane, it belongs to somebody else, you'll only fly it when they invite you to, and it could stop at any moment.
Yeah.
So they had their own pilots coming along, so they certainly didn't have the need for pilots. So they asked if we could fly it for a few months, and that would be it. So I needed to do something about it and quick. That's decided, well, actually, I've got to find a way to own one of these. And the only way I was going to do it was to save up in the form of buying a wreck and then in stages funding it along the way. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, amazing. But it was a big task. And I managed to find one of a few Spitfires that were recovered from a South African scrapyard by a collector in Sussex, not far from me. And he was happy to let one of those go for the sum of 12,000 quid, which in today's money, that's relatively small for a Spitfire. But if you'd seen what I loaded into the back of a transit van, you might have questioned it. Yeah, my wife at the time certainly questioned it. So what have you done?
Well, so from that, we now have two hangars full of aircraft.
That's right.
So can we go and have a look? Is that all right?
Yeah, let's go.
Brilliant. Okay, let's go.
Hello, it's James Holland here. And on the very odd chance you've missed it, I've got a new book out, Sicily 43, about the epic 38-day battle that raged in July and August 1943. It's a story that involves breathtaking action at sea, in the air, and on land. Its conquest involved airborne operations, daring raids by special forces, the harnessing of the mafia, attacks across mosquito-infested plains, assaults up almost sheer faces of rock and scrub, and featured an astonishing array of highly colourful characters, and all to a backdrop of relentless heat, dust, mosquitoes, and truly brutal terrain. There's a special edition with extra content at waterstones.com, but you can also get it at Amazon, an array of supermarkets, or any of those wonderful independents that are dotted around the country. Thank you for listening, and grazie mille.
We're stood beside the Greek Spitfire. If people have been watching inside the Spitfire factory or more for, this is the sort of central story of the program, that it goes from being basically the fuselage to this aircraft. It's a spoiler, it flies at the end. Tell us about this plane.
This is a very special aeroplane in terms of its originality. It's probably the most original Spitfire that we've got in the hangar. We've restored it, we did it very quickly because we were on a timeline, as you could see in the program. So we've restored it very quickly, it's very original. But because of the COVID situation, the aeroplane's still here, which is good. Yeah. We can enjoy it for a little bit longer. But it's got a fantastic history, and one of the major things is the fact that one of the pilots that had actually flown it is still around today.
George Dunn.
Yeah. And I won't say that he regularly comes to the hangar, but he does come along. He was here just a few weeks ago on the Battle of Britain Day when we got all the aeroplanes out of the hangar. But as you can see, it's a lovely looking aeroplane.
Beautiful,
yeah. And we're still tinkering with it. There's Alex there. I don't quite know what he's doing, but he's got the engine cover off and doing some minor adjustments.
Yeah. But Peter, I love the story about him turning up for the first time here.
Absolutely. I mean, that was quite something. We do hangar tours where people pay to come and visit the hangar. They're guided round. And George did just that. So we'd paid, just like everybody else, but I try and sort of justify it, because he didn't look like a veteran. You know, he wandered around exactly like the rest, and he certainly didn't look at somebody in their mid-90s.
No.
But it was quite something when he happened to spot the Greek Air Force markings and the story behind it, and just made a passing comment to the guide that he'd flown these for the Greek Air Force back in the day.
Yeah.
And the guide asked him if he wouldn't mind bringing his logbook in, otherwise we may well have missed it.
Yeah, it is truly amazing.
Yeah.
So George flew it to deliver to the And they'd go with the Lancaster and come back in the... Lancaster would navigate and get them there.
That's right.
They'd go via Cyprus from Egypt and and then fly them... Once they dropped the Spitfires off, fly them back in the Lank.
That's right,
he did it. He did two,
God,
two
a
runs.
Journey I'd love to do.
It's absolutely incredible.
I mean, wow, that would be fantastic.
And then it was in the Greek Air Force and flew in the Civil War, right?
It did. That's right. So it, as far as the Greeks are concerned, it's got more Greek Air Force history or relevant history than... Perhaps we'd look at it with a view that we'd rather have it in Royal Air Force markings, but it's their aeroplane, they funded it, and it's very important to them.
Yeah.
So they're just waiting for the opportunity to take it back.
And we clip wings as well.
Yes, that's absolutely right. It was used as low-level strike and attack, so it's got the wingtips removed to make it a much more manoeuvrable aeroplane at low level.
Have you flown... Go on, James.
Well, I was going to say, most of the clip wings ones were... A lot of them were operating in Italy because, of course, there was no Luftwaffe by the end of the war, or virtually none. So most of the stuff that Spitfires were doing in Italy, and Spitfires were really suited to Italy because the ranges were quite short.
Yeah.
You didn't need to kind of sort of go halfway to Germany or anything like that. You just got to go up the leg of Italy. But of course, a lot of the work they're doing is these sort of tactical these TACRs, which is these sort of tactical reconnaissance flights. So you're going to take photographs of enemy positions,
and brass them up.
And of course, what you've got in Italy is you've got a lot of these sort of very narrow valleys, mountainous valleys. And the clip wing just means that you can go down, and if you're sort of flying over, I don't know, the Seta Valley or the Reno Valley or whatever it might be in the Apennines, and you see a little column of enemy trucks and what have you going down the road, you can immediately drop down and attack them, and it just gives you that greater manoeuvrability because it's got the higher wing loading at that lower level.
Have you flown this one yourself?
Not yet, but I will do.
How often do you get to fly? Because, I mean, you know, you start off... The dream is owning a Spitfire. You buy the wreck. Now you're surrounded by the bloody things.
Well, let me tell you something. That flying them is the easy bit.
Right.
The hardest bit is actually restoring them and putting them back in the air and maintaining them.
Yeah.
It's easy to fly.
Yeah.
But the finding of the spares, and the chasing of the parts is more difficult. And in fact, I get more of a buzz from that. To see an aeroplane come from nothing to flying out. That is far more of an achievement.
So how much kind of sort of, you know, horse trading is there over parts? Because you're obviously competing with you and John Romain, obviously kind of sort of, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Well, to be honest with you, it is more horse trading than cash. Cash doesn't necessarily buy parts. We've got quite a collection of parts, probably the biggest collection in the world. None of them are for sale. They're all destined for our projects and obviously keeping our two-seaters running. But I won't sell any of them. The only way I'd let them go is to trade for parts that we need.
So if someone's got like a pressure gauge you need and you'll swap it
for something similar value.
Exactly right.
And that's the only way. Occasionally, the generations changes with collections of parts do come available. But it's pretty rare.
Is it a big scene or a small scene?
Very small.
Yeah, that's what I was literally just about to say. Because the warbird world is a small one, isn't it?
It is.
Everybody
small.
Knows everybody, and it's an international world as well, isn't it?
It is. Yes.
And I mean, how do you get? I mean, just say I wanted to buy a Spitfire. How would I go about it? I mean, would I ring you up as a first port of call?
You could do. We've got projects. We've got unrestored Spitfires that are still waiting for homes. We don't advertise them. Because we don't need to, and we're already running at maximum capacity, but it's that needs careful managing.
Okay. So, go on.
Is this one of those businesses, though, if you want to make £1 million in restoring Spitfires, start with 10 million?
Yeah, you've got it exactly right. They are, this to me is just a labour of love.
Right.
But an enjoyable one.
Yeah.
And 7 days a week for me.
What I'd really like to do is I'd really like to buy
a
Mark V. Well,
no, you want a Spitfire?
I'd like a Mark V. I'd like it with a Vokes filter, and I'd like it done up in the markings of Screwball Burling from Malta in the summer of 1942. That's what I'd like.
What we would need to do...
I mean, obviously I've got 10 million.
Yeah, and you'd probably need it. But what you would need to do, you need to find a basis of a project. You need to find something which is recognisable...
As a Mark V,
and you need to establish the identity of that aircraft, and then you need to obviously bring the Civil Aviation Authority into the loop, because they need to agree that it's an aircraft that you can identify, you can register it, and it is restorable, and it's not a replacement. You cannot have a new built aircraft. You need to have something to start with, something tangible to start with.
Wow. You I need to get writing a bit more.
Yeah. Yeah, you need to, we need more Patreons.
Right. Right. So, onwards. So, I want to look at
this end
wing.
Of the hangar, there's the completed aircraft, basically. But if we push back through the hangar, we can see some things. That there's. I see a wing. You want to look at the wing, don't you, James?
Prepared for us, ready for us. I mean, I mean, we're both a bit obsessed with Spitfire wings.
Yeah.
And the construction of them. And one thing that I would say, whenever I've seen a wing in that profile held up, you know, vertically like that on its side, I was looking at it, I go, I literally can't see two pieces the same.
No, and you
two
won't.
Two bits on it.
You won't. Every single part is different to the next. There are no two pieces the same, and there are
not
lots.
One.
No, exactly right. So there's a lot of work goes in those. In fact, the fuselage, which if you've got a fuselage complete and you've got some camouflage, some paint on it, it looks like you're getting somewhere. In fact, you're not. Yeah. You're a long way from being finished.
And there's your bit, Al.
Yeah, I've got a paperweight.
One of those,
spar, yeah.
You can see the construction there, the tubes that are inserted.
Yeah. And then bent, so they lock, yeah. so they lock together.
The shape is there, and that gives the wings the dihedral, which gives the aircraft some stability in flight.
So that bending process, that's what strengthens it, does it?
Yeah, it locks it. Those aren't soldered or anything.
That's right.
They bend it so they click together.
That's it. They won't move then.
So
you have to, when you're restoring a plane and the wings is not good enough, you have to make this.
You'd have to. Yeah.
I mean, how do you do that?
Well, we don't make these. We actually buy them from a company that's been making these for years.
On the Isle of Wight. On the Isle of Wight.
Yeah.
So they've been making these for years.
But they have a great big jig, and
that's it.
They crank it to put the bends in
and get the shape. Yep. And then once you've got that shape, all these tubes are then locked together. But that shape is not just to lock the tubes together. Yeah. That gives the wings the dihedral.
Yeah.
So the sweep up, which gives the aircraft some basic.
How many rivets in the wing?
I wish I knew. I've lost
it's
count.
It's sort of 7,000 yeah, the entire it aircraft, is, isn't it?
I mean, I'm just looking at this in the sort of cross section of the wing, looking down it. It's
very
just
complicated.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
I'm going to take a picture of that.
Now, is this more or less complicated than, say, the construction of the wing of an ME-109?
Oh, 109 is very basic. It's almost single pressed frames. No right. different to a Cessna 152 or a Piper.
So it's where the over-engineering rule breaks
yep.
down.
Yeah, so it's a better made.
Oh yeah, you could easily match the 109 could be much more easily mass produced than this. Almost it's one piece at a time, and thousands of pieces, as you can see.
So no wonder they had trouble getting Castle Bromwich off the ground if it's that complex because every rivet hole's being drilled and everything.
I know it is.
Yeah, Lord Beaverbrook was lucky because when he took over on the whenever it was 17th of May 1940, it was just
they were just getting
to the swing where they were just getting to the swing of it. I mean, where he was brilliant was that he then really, really kicked butt and kind of changed working process and all the rest of it. But so it was a combination of timing and his quite draconian work ethic.
Just playing behind us. I mean, you're going to knock your head off there with the wingtip. What's this aircraft here? It's in tropical colours.
This aircraft was delivered to North Africa, and it flew from North Africa and travelled up through Malta into Italy. So these are in its desert colours.
Wow.
And quite
Mark
interesting.
Mark 9 again?
Yeah, it is. 1943 Mark 9, very early one. And because it's got its in desert markings, it has a survival kit there in the cockpit, which if you just look in the cockpit to the rear, you can see a little tank with a little, what appears to be a screw thread.
Yep.
And that's a water tank. So if the pilot
goes down
force
in the
landed,
desert.
Yeah, in the desert, he's got some water. And that was only fitted to the desert aircraft.
Amazing. I never knew that. Yeah. That's brilliant, isn't it?
And that's the only one of those tanks that I've ever managed to get hold of. But I can't even remember where I got it from now. But it's in this aircraft now.
Looks wow. incredible.
Yeah.
So how long does a wing, or is this a how long is a piece of string question? How long does it take to restore a wing?
It takes two men 6 months.
Right.
One wing.
Bloody hell. Yeah.
But there's actually...
And they're doing that all day?
Yes, they are. Actually, when you look at the fuselage, it looks more significant than the wing, but it's not. There's more work to construct one wing than there is a fuselage.
Because the fuselage is essentially a tube, isn't it?
It is, with a tube frame. And press frames, essentially.
Yeah.
Not individual parts. Like there
well,
are
they have to carry all the stress and strain of flight.
Right. Yeah, they do. They do, absolutely. So it's always when we do a project, or if we're doing a project for an owner, they always like to see the fuselage with the livery, the paint, the finish, and they could sit in it if they want to.
But that's where the action is.
Exactly. But it's not the most difficult part of the job. In fact, you're less than a tenth of the way there when you finish the fuselage. You've got a long way to go. So many bits, lots of pieces. Not just the wings and the fuselage. You've got the fin,
yeah,
the tail planes, and all the control surfaces. And they're all just as bloody complicated as this wing. They're not made for simplicity.
Well, it's amazing because at the moment we're watching him doing the... I can never remember the bit... So at the end of where you account for the head of the screw.
Countersink.
Countersink. So he's doing the countersinking now.
That's right.
And that is just done with the human eye, and it's
it is
very gentle.
Yeah.
Because you obviously don't want to do too much, but you want to make sure that the screw fits perfectly.
Yeah, so the head
so
is
he puts the screw in. A little bit more, just and it's literally a couple of revolutions, and that's all it is. I mean, it's. You can see why it requires so much finesse.
Exactly right.
Such a difficult job.
And in fact, almost every rivet is like that, because these are such thin skins that they're easily damaged or they're easily overworked. In other words, a rivet goes in too deeply and causes a little bit of a dimple in the skin. So you've got to be very careful. Yeah. These guys know exactly what they're doing.
So it takes you 6 months to make a wing. How long would they have knocked one out in 1941?
I think a
lot of people working on them, don't they?
Yeah, lots of people. There would have been more than two working. They would have got that down to a matter of weeks, not months.
Wow.
Yeah. They had to.
But they're just doing it all the time.
Yeah, I know, but just for point of comparison.
Amazing.
Yeah, it's incredible.
Yeah, they're big. There's certain photographs that I've seen of Castle Bromwich where they made Spitfires of rows and rows of wing jigs. And it's almost one person walking from one wing to the next, doing exactly the same job.
What would you give for being able to spend an afternoon at Castle Bromwich in 1941 and watch the?
Well, I don't know. I've had enough of this place.
But I tell you what, though, makes you appreciate, doesn't it, the fact that Britain produced 132,500 aircraft in the Second World War.
Well,
you know, of all types, some bigger, some smaller, but an awful lot bigger. Well, how many Spitfires was it? 22,000.
That's right.
You've got. Yeah. You know, I mean, that's a heck of a lot, isn't it?
Yeah, not
22,000. I mean, that you know, that's like, you know, what's that? That's sort of Trent Bridget capacity, isn't it?
Yeah.
Lots of Spitfires. Like yeah. Where have they all gone? Yeah, and we scratch around looking for a piece here and a piece there.
They're all in the ocean, aren't they? They're off Rockall. They got dumped in the sea, didn't they?
And there's those pictures of rows and rows and rows of Spitfire, sort of, you know, 20 quid.
Yeah.
50 quid or whatever.
And there was some... these engines are... with some Merlin engines here to look at. Are they to look at? Are these ever going to...
These two...
Those are Griffins, aren't they?
Those are Griffins.
These are Mark 9 Spitfire engines, and they have the two-speed supercharger.
Right.
With the intercooler here. So because it's got a faster supercharger, higher gear, as you compress any gas, it gets warm. But you need to cool that gas down again before it goes into the cylinders. Hence, it goes through this. Inside there is a like a radiator matrix through which is running coolant, so it's cold. So the heated gas goes through there, cools down before it goes into the cylinders. Otherwise, you end up with possibly a pre-ignition.
Yeah, misfires and stuff.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So that's the idea of that. If you look at this engine here, which is an earlier engine. In fact, this is a pre-war Merlin, 1938 engine. Doesn't have it. Yeah. So it's a lot less power. This is the 950 horsepower Merlin 3.
Yeah.
And this is the 1600 odd horsepower Merlin 60 series.
And that's the supercharger doing that.
It is, absolutely. Because this part of the engine, the cylinder banks, apart from modifications, they're essentially the same.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's all governed by the supercharger and the way that works. And the injection carburetor too here.
Well, which then takes you onto the jet engine with the supercharger and all that stuff. These look a bit more knackered though.
Well, actually, this engine has been recovered. It was recovered, I think it's about 3 years ago now. It was recovered in Wiltshire. It was significant, and as much as this sort of gives you some idea.
Was that the one that was dug up on Salisbury Plain?
Yeah, it was. This was a presentation Spitfire that this engine came from, and it was presented by Lloyd's Bank. Right. So funded by all the employees of Lloyds Bank.
Yeah.
And all of the documentation exists in the Lloyds Bank archives of where all the money came from. So it's from the cashiers to the cleaners. Everybody put a shilling or two into the pot, and they came up with a 7,000 quid that they donated to fund this aircraft. And it's got a bit of a history. It did serve with an Australian squadron and was flown by a couple of aces before it ended up with a training unit, and this is the best that they could come up with. They
crashed it.
They crashed it, and that was the end of it. So anyway, so some big significance that the Lloyds Bank actually funded the recovery of it. So anyway, so it's nice to see, and it tells the story of the Spitfire Fund, really.
Look inside.
Exactly, yeah, it's all there.
The gearing in there, yeah.
This is just
pistons another and
yeah, this is another engine from a Halifax bomber that was recovered not so far from here.
So you've a fuselage up here on a
jig. There you are. There's a fuselage. It's empty. It's a tube, as you said. And most of the frames, from the at least two-thirds of them, are just pressed. Are interchangeable.
These are just sort of clamps, are they?
Yeah, they're just... these hold the skins in place, and then you remove that and put the rivet in.
Got you.
You need something to hold it all together, otherwise it's just all over the place.
And you can only get so far in the jig, can't you?
That's right. We have to take it out, and we can finish the lower skins because the jig gets in the way. But at that point, it's sort of self-sustaining, and it's rigid when you take it out.
Yeah. Won't fall apart.
How do you get it out again? It looks like it's trapped.
It's out through the front. The front of the jig. You can see some cross members at the front. They come out, and there's a pulley at the front, and you just hang the back on the pulley, and then just trundle it out. Simple as that.
Incredible. Right, now we're moving through to the calm and quiet in here.
Yes, we're not
it?
In a workshop anymore. We're in it's like a Spitfire car park.
Well, it is really. This is where the live aircraft are kept. There's little or no maintenance going on in here. Only perhaps the odd maintenance check, which just means looking at the airplane for a day or so.
Cooper Vogue and then Steve McQueen's Jeep.
It is, absolutely. Yeah, this is very quirky, isn't it? Have something with Steve McQueen's, especially the Jeep, because the Jeep's the part of what we're all about anyway, but this one's quite different. It was sitting here perfectly sort of unused, but one of my sons has got in it, look, and has been through the mud in it, and it's now soiled.
Now, the thing is, though, we've been talking about Spitfires a lot, but how can we ignore this? There's a 109.
Well, I think we're going to do that in the next one.
Are we doing that in the next podcast?
Yeah.
All right, so you're going to have to watch the next one then. There we go.
Yeah,
we'll do 109s and Hurricanes.
This is what happens when I don't read the emails.
There's a 605 engine there, look, upside down.
Wow. Well, we'll get to that another time. So, is your original Spitfire here then?
No, it isn't actually. It's the one we're talking about. It's over the one with the
Spirit
experimental. Yeah, with the experimental propeller. It's not here. We actually had to move it away yesterday because we're jammed solid at the moment with Spitfires.
So, if people they won't have seen the episode yet, I think we're talking about the experimental. It's in the last one. The experimental propeller. This is the most amazing thing, James. There's a guy who makes Spitfire propellers now.
Yeah.
And he's found the material.
Not Rotol anymore.
They're made to the. It's not Rotol. It's made, but they are made to the exact specification that Rotol made them in the first place. Because what we're using at the moment are Hoffman blades. They're made in Germany, and they're made to the way that the Hoffman decided to make them.
Yeah.
And they're not exactly the same. They're made of a softer material, and they do have certain restrictions. Whereas the British made propellers now we've proved them, there are no restrictions.
Yeah, it's incredible. It's just
the Rotol ones.
Yeah,
exactly.
Rupert, it's this guy Rupert Wasey, and a neighbour was having a clear out and found a linen.
That's right.
Linen drawing of how to make a Spitfire, the right propeller for the Mark 9. Absolutely
how
incredible.
Amazing.
And the right material, and it's like a super composite, it's a birch composite.
Compressed
right. Composite. So like a sort of mega.
Because these are metal, aren't they?
Mega MDF.
No, they're made of wood.
They're wood.
They're wood.
They are all wood,
aren't
they?
They are all wood, yeah. Only the very early Spitfires with the three-bladed de Havilland propeller, they were metal. But the Mark 9s and the Griffins, so the four and five-bladed propellers, are wood.
They're like super dense wood fibre material, like MDF basically.
Okay.
In fact, if you go and take a look, and look hard enough, you can actually see lines in the finish on the propeller. That's actually the wooden strips or the wooden blocks that actually make the propeller blade. But not as good as the British made or the original blades. They are limited to power and sort of certain things.
Yeah, he cuts them on a CNC machine, right. Isn't it? It's incredible. Yeah.
Wow. And this one is the original trainer, isn't it?
It is.
So this was MT-818.
MT-818, so Mark 8 Spitfire, originally built as a single-seater. It didn't actually go to squadron service. It ended up at Boscombe Down as a test piece. So they were using it for testing various things. And one of those things was anti-spin chutes, where they would, in the event of the aircraft getting out of control, they'd eject a parachute just forward of the fin. You can see a little hatch.
Yeah.
So that's been there since 1944. In there was a parachute which would have been ejected and obviously would have straightened the aircraft up. Pilot could have get rid of it once he got it back under control, and away he went. How successful it was, I don't know, but this is the only aircraft we know that's got it. But as I say, because this aircraft is so original, it's never been completely restored.
Yeah,
it's still got some of its single seat bits and pieces still attached to it.
Right, so it's the true hybrid.
Oh, absolutely. So, and then it was sold back to Vickers in 1946. They put it on the civilian register and did the modification. So if you look close enough inside the fuselage, you can actually see where the actual frames have been cut and modified and bits added and taken away. So it's actually quite something. So it is the only surviving Spitfire prototype. And it's got its the engine it actually flew with. So
no.
Yeah, the engine was removed in the 50s because during a period of maintenance, an engineer dropped some locking wire down inside the engine.
Yeah.
Right, what do we do now? We better take it out. So they took the engine out, put another one in. So that engine just sort of drifted from pillar to post with people with various ideas of putting it into cars and boats and things. But fortunately, that never happened. And it was found about 10 years ago, in fact by me, and on the search for spares and bits and pieces, there was a chap that used to put the engines into cars, and he passed away. His brother ended up with all the stuff and he was selling it. I got to find out, went down to his farm in Sussex, and he says, interested in that complete engine as well. I said, well, yes. He said, I've got the logbook for it. I said, really? I said, there are no logbooks with Merlin engines. He says, no, I've got the logbook in here. When he showed it to me, there was a civil registration of this aircraft.
Amazing.
Incredible.
And it says in the logbook that removed due to lost locking wire. And then coincidentally, a year before, because this aeroplane had been in the States, it had been brought back in, and the owner only lived 10 miles away. So I phoned him, I said, you're not going to believe this. I found the original engine of your aeroplane.
That is amazing.
So it went to Retro Track and Air to be overhauled. And when they pulled it apart, they found that piece of wire that was...
They did find it.
Yeah, they found it. Yeah. Been there since 55. So the engine, fortunately, had never been run or used. And
absolutely incredible.
Yeah, so he's back with it now, and there it is.
Right.
That's amazing.
Yeah, well, I think that's enough for one episode. I think we're going to do some more of this. So we'll see you soon, everybody, with more stuff from the Heritage Hangar here at Biggin Hill.
Oh, cheers, Peter.
No problem at all. No problem.